आओ जिंदगी की सांझ को साझा कर ले, आओ जिंदगी की सांझ को साझा कर ले, आओ जिंदगी की सांझ को साझा कर ले, आओ जिंदगी की सांझ को साझा कर ले।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, बड़ों को प्रणाम, साथियों को नमस्ते और छोटों को प्यार। थैंक यू ऑल फॉर ज्वाइनिंग अस टुडे। COVID-19 या कोरोना इज अ ड्रेडेड वर्ड एंड नो वन कैन प्रिडिक्ट व्हाट फ्यूचर वुड बी इन दीज कोविड टाइम्स। बट ये बात भी सच है कि सही प्रिकॉशन एंड केयर से हम अपने आप को कोरोना के इम्पैक्ट से बचा के रख सकते हैं। व्हेन आई से इम्पैक्ट ऑफ कोरोना, इट इज नॉट जस्ट अबाउट द इन्फेक्शन और द डिजीज, इट इज ऑल्सो अबाउट द अदर इम्पैक्ट ड्यू टू द ओवरऑल एनवायरमेंट, इंक्लूडिंग द इफेक्ट ऑन इकोनमी एंड स्टेइंग इंडोर्स ड्यू टू सेल्फ इम्पोज्ड और स्टेट इम्पोज्ड लॉकडाउन। We see higher level of stress too in today's time, and many more such things have come up or increased. आज देश में अनलॉक 2 की प्रक्रिया शुरू हो चुकी है, पर याद है वो लॉकडाउन 1 के दिन जब सब कुछ बंद था, घर से बाहर निकलना बैंड था। हमारे बीच में आज भी कुछ ऐसे लोग हैं जो उसी लॉकडाउन 1 की तरह की जिंदगी और रिस्ट्रिक्शंस के में जी रहे हैं। ये वो हैं जिन्हें हम वल्नरेबल सेक्शन ऑफ आवर सोसाइटी कहते हैं, घर के बच्चे और हमारे बुजुर्ग। हरिकृत एनजीओ पिछले 17 साल से बुजुर्गों के लिए एक बेहतर एनवायरनमेंट बनाने के लिए कार्यरत है। इस बात से कैसे अनजान रहे हम कि हमारे बुजुर्ग आज भी लॉकडाउन में है। हरिकृत एनजीओ की फाउंडर सेक्रेटरी जेवी मनीषा जी इस बात को लेकर कई बुद्धिजीवी और डिसीशन मेकर से डायलॉग में रही हैं, और ये वेबिनार सीरीज सांची सांच हेल्थ टिप्स उन डिस्कशंस का रिजल्ट है। इतने लंबे अरसे तक लॉकडाउन में रहना आसान नहीं, ये बात हम सब समझते हैं। इसलिए इस वेबिनार सीरीज द्वारा हम अलग अलग टॉपिक पर बात करेंगे जो हमारे सीनियर्स के लिए फायदेमंद हो। सो द हेल्थ टिप्स आर नॉट जस्ट अबाउट योर फिजिकल हेल्थ। इन एडिशन टू फिजिकल हेल्थ, इन द फ्यूचर एपिसोड्स वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट मल्टीपल एलिमेंट्स रिलेटेड टू मेंटल हेल्थ, फाइनेंशियल हेल्थ, सिक्योरिटी, लीगल हेल्थ, and many more things that contribute to our overall well-being. Yes, all our discussions have our elders as the center point. However, courtesy our experts, all the topics will have takeaways for everyone else too. साथ में हमें इस बात का भी ध्यान रखना है कि elders से related issues उनके caregivers को भी impact करते हैं। इसलिए हम समझते हैं कि फैमिली में हर किसी को हमारे इस सीरीज से फायदा होगा। टुडे वी हैव एन अमेजिंग स्पीकर एंड एक्सपर्ट हु विल शेयर सम ग्रेट इनसाइट्स ऑन होम्योपैथिक वे ऑफ लाइफ। बिफोर आई इंट्रोड्यूस द स्पीकर, जस्ट अ क्विक पॉइंट, हो सकता है आपको ड्यूरिंग द टॉक या उसके बाद कुछ क्वेश्चंस पूछने हो हमारे एक्सपर्ट से। आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट यू टू नोट देम डाउन, एंड हम टॉक के एंड में क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन भी करेंगे। सो यू कैन आस्क योर क्वेश्चंस दैट टाइम। चैट बॉक्स आपको नजर आएगा, उसमें आप अपने क्वेश्चंस लिख सकते हैं जो हम अपने एक्सपर्ट से पूछेंगे। एंड द आर एक्सपर्ट टुडे इज डॉक्टर गीता अरोड़ा, हु विल बी हैप्पी टू आंसर देम। सो इंट्रोड्यूसिंग द एक्सपर्ट स्पीकर टुडे, डॉक्टर गीता रानी अरोड़ा इज BHMS and MD in homeopathy. She has been helping her patients for over 15 years through her clinical practice. Over the years, she has treated multiple cases of asthma, allergic disorder, psoriasis, eczema, to name a few. She has been associated with homeopathy research for many years now and has presented multiple papers both at national and international platform. She has been part of homeopathy medicine manufacturing process and has made significant contribution in the associated regulatory work too. A combination and balance of regulatory work and clinical practice makes Dr. Geeta Arora a preferred name in the field. She is also the faculty member at London School of Homeopathy, has been associated with homeopathy book publishing. She has till date presented over 30 papers at national and international platforms and has almost equal number of published articles under her belt. They say hard work never goes unnoticed. Dr. Geeta Arora has been the recipient of multiple awards too, including an award from Ministry of Ayush, Government of India. I can continue to talk about many of her accomplishments, but you all are here not to listen to me, but to hear Dr. Arora share her insights. However, before I hand over the spotlight to her, main ek baat zarur kehna chahungi. I met Geeta ji for the first time almost 3 years back, courtesy Manisha ji, the founder of Harikrut NGO. We were meeting to discuss an event we were planning at that time, which we were able to do quite successfully at Teen Murti Bhavan. But that's not what I want to share. I met Geeta ji and she had an amazing impact on me and left a strong impression. Frankly, there was nothing over the top that happened that day. It was just her personality, her presence that leaves a mark on. It is said that an advisor or a doctor is effective if they can leave an impact. Dr. Geeta Arora does just that and it comes naturally to her. It is a privilege to have her here with us today. On this note, it gives me great pleasure to invite Geeta ji to take over. The field is all yours, Geeta ji, now.
Thank you so much, Rashi. You have introduced me like never before. I mean, it's you are rising people's expectations. But yes, I must start by saying that the energy which you have is always so infectious and tremendous. And I just love that, you know. And similarly, I have a beautiful connect with Manisha. It's like even if we meet after a year, we are like as if we just met yesterday. And Harikrut is something which is, even if I don't contribute that much, but my heart and my love for Harikrut is always there. You know, Manisha knows that, you know that. So I wish you all the best and congratulate you for the wonderful work you're doing for senior citizens. So I will move ahead. And I do a lot of presentations for homeopathy, but this is something which I'm feeling very proud and happy about, that I can talk to so many people whom otherwise I'm not able to meet. And I hope you're able to convey some good part of what we are going to share here with. So I'm going to start sharing the screen. Rashi, may I do that?
Please, ma'am, go ahead.
Great. Okay. So when we said that... Rashi, will you take care of the people who are trying to join in? Okay, great. So we are going to talk about elders still under lockdown. So rightly put by Harikrut as a topic, because as the lockdown started, we all were under lockdown. But today, even if the lockdown is opened after lockdown 4, it has been an advisory from the government to keep elders and children, yes, of course, at home. So what's happening is that for kids, let's be very honest, we all are there around at least a time in evenings, even if for working parents, they are trying to do their best because they feel concerned about it, that kids are not able to go out, they cannot play. But elders are there, they were there at home earlier, but their activity is grossly restricted. So they're ending. So let's talk about it, what we can do for them and what are the things which we need to take care of them. Also, this is especially taking care of our senior citizens who are living away from their children due to various reasons, that kids are not in the country or they stay separately, whatever. So I like to touch those parts. So first thing I want to tell them all that you are not alone. This is the first thing which you have to remember. Like, we all are in the midst of a global pandemic. There is fear and anxiety, which we have to recognize. We don't have to say that there is no stress, there is no anxiety. This is there because this is a very, very natural phenomenon. Everybody, I am a doctor, even there are phases when I feel very anxious about that I'm just limited to my home and clinic. And you would say that I'm just at home. So it's natural to have anxiety and fear at this time. And we will talk about how we can handle this particular thing. There is also a fear about the disease. I think the last such a huge pandemic, let me tell you, share a fact with you, was in 1920. That was a Spanish flu pandemic, which was spread throughout the world. There have been other small epidemics in the world, but none has been huge like that. So this is something which has affected everyone on the planet. So I think in people's lifetime, there will be only a few people who are seeing second such episode. This is an experience which we all will remember throughout our lives. But now the reactions may vary from one person to another. For someone, it might be very normal. For someone, it might be depressing. For someone, it is like, okay, I can manage and stuff like that. But yes, we all have to acknowledge that our lives will continue to change for a while and remain different. This is different than our usual lifestyle, and we have to cope with this particular. Now, why this lockdown has been done? So a lockdown always is, where should I put this so that it doesn't really affect the screen. Okay. So lockdown is basically to avoid the risk of contamination when there is a disease which spreads from one person to another. So it doesn't really mean that you actually have to restrict everything what you do in your normal life. It's a concept of stay at home or shelter in place. And the purpose of lockdown is to prevent the spread of infection from one person to another. That's the main idea. So what exactly it means? It doesn't mean that you cannot go out at all. It means that you should step out of the house only for buying an essential necessity. You should reduce the number of trips outside. Ideally, what you should do is you should have just one person of the house going out. Any one family member who can go out, and rest all should stay at home. And that trip also should be, I suggest here that you should plan your trips. You can plan your monthly groceries, order everything together, order online. In fact, I taught one of my senior citizen neighbors how to use a particular social website for ordering online. And they were so happy to do it. And I taught my parents about it. They're still to learn a little few more steps. So, but this is something which you can do. You order online or buy on a local shopkeeper. Avoid going out. Buying stuff for a few weeks. Plan your purchases. This is a very simple step, but it can go a long way. Do not order vegetables every day. Order once in 3 days. So the feeling of fear is there. Why? Because constantly you're hearing the news, the phone calls, the radio, and it's all bombardment of ideas. The numbers of rising cases, the numbers in the country, the numbers in the city, especially for people living in Delhi. Yes, the numbers are more. But I would suggest here that please restrict your listening to TV for only a few hours. Do not listen to the news for throughout the day. I might be having a biased opinion here. I've usually seen that the senior men are usually watching the news more and the females want to watch something else. So just restrict your hour of watching news. If you want to know the numbers, 1 hour is good enough for that. Restrict that. That is my first request and advice to everyone. Then let us talk about few do's and don'ts, which I would like to suggest here. Do not follow any sensational news or social media posts or WhatsApp or Facebook, which bring in negative information. You should only make sure that you access and believe only the most reliable source of information for self-protection. This means you can restrict yourself to even one or two channels which are reliable, which have more factual news, and only watch those channels. Do not keep discussing all the time about who got sick and how. Learn about the people who got well and recovered. I know a lot of people who suffered from COVID are better going home now. I know so many people who are about 90 years of age and they had COVID. They are fine now. They've gone home. So definitely people with comorbidity have a higher risk, but it still does not mean that you cannot recover. You can recover. There are cases. There's a case of 103-year-old lady who recovered and went home. The 92-year-old director of a medical hospital contracted it. He needed oxygen. He was admitted in the hospital and he went home well. So if you have symptoms, the next thing is if you have symptoms, which worry you, please do not hide your symptoms. Do not hesitate to talk to your physician. Talk to your physician. In fact, these days, since the telemedicine, which was not really allowed in India earlier, has been officially permitted as in the month of March itself. So contact your physician, go for an online consultation, do a video consultation. So the physician can see you, he can talk to you, he can see your state of your health and advise you for your symptoms. Don't try to do home remedies if you have any symptoms related to your existing mental condition or any symptom related to upper respiratory tract infection. Because sometimes the fear of getting COVID avoids patient actually seeking attention. I saw that in few cases I'm seeing for COVID. So I would really discourage that. Because a doctor would be the right person to help you differentiate if it looks like a common cold or you do have symptoms of COVID. Yes, you can Google search your symptoms, but I strongly discourage that. I encourage you to speak to your physician or a local physician who's available online to help you out. Do not go out unless very necessary. Stick to a known advice, hand hygiene, keeping a physical distance from others. These are the things which have been advised by the government, by the medical institutes, and that's what you have to stick to. Let's go a little in detail and let's go step by step. So what can you do staying at home? The first and foremost thing I suggest is have a fixed schedule. This is a very, very important part. I'm sure you all taught us when we were kids that having an important schedule is important. So many of the elders I still know are following a very routine schedule and some are not. So try and follow a schedule. Get up in the morning at a fixed time, have your bed tea, do your meditation, do yoga, do some exercises. You can do that in your room or you can also go out if there is a park next. Basically, going out does not mean that you just have to restrict yourself in the four walls. If there is an open area where there is not movement of people, you can choose a time where people are not visiting. For example, a small colony park. You can go early in the morning or you can go late evening where there are not many people. Maintain a social distance. Wear your mask if you are walking. But yes, if you're exercising extensively, please remember to remove your mask. So do your yoga at a particular time. Do your exercise at a particular time. Prepare your breakfast at a set time. Have your breakfast at a set time. Have your lunch at a set time. And do activities at a regular routine. That's the first thing I would like to discuss this in the end again. The routine is the most important thing. Second is please distract yourself from negative emotions about the news, about the numbers, about the deaths, about the, you know, in the news they have been saying that yes, elderly people have more risk. But please remember that a lot of elderly people are recovering. It all depends on your emotional state, on your health condition, and the medical care and the timely care you start with. So the most important thing is you notice your symptom and get help. That's what is the most important aspect. And yes, this is the time I would strongly suggest that all the people you have to, today, before we end, I would like everybody to tell me one hobby which they think they can get back to. I know I have, I think, Dr. Roma online. She's a medical doctor and I think she's there with us. And she shared so many things which she has been doing during this COVID. And she sent me a message. She's been doing gardening. I love the flower pictures which she put on Facebook. And, you know, so she was talking about the mental games you're playing, carom, dodo. So go back to all that. Even if you're just two people living together, play all those games. Ludo, carom. There is another one. What do you have? And Scrabble. And all these games, just order them online. Pick up and spend your time playing that. You don't have to sit and feel that you're bored. Do those activities. Yes, one more game, which my mom, dad have been playing these days, Sequence. That's what I was trying to recollect. So play such games with your spouse. Play such games with your grandchildren, those who have grandchildren at home. So spend quality time. Eat well, drink plenty of fluids. As we talked about it, be physically active. So those who have good phones, you can also try doing some, clicking some nice pictures. You can, those who are doing cooking, click pictures, keep a record of what all you're doing, share with your friends, share with your old relatives. So this was one simple list which I made, that this is what you should have your day routine written. That's a suggestion. Morning exercise, yoga, bed, tea, gardening. Okay, here I would like to suggest everyone, those who, some of them I know, or some of you people already have your huge gardens. Those who do not have gardens, I would suggest you all to have at least 4-5 plants in your house. I made a list, which I wanted to suggest you. One, all of you should have snake plant in your rooms if you can keep. Keep money plant in your balconies. Keep syngonium in your balconies. And keep tulsi plants in your house. There was one more which I listed, lemongrass. These are 5 plants I would suggest you all can have. Take care of them. Let them grow in your garden. They're all beneficial plants. And do meditation. There are so many online aids available these days. Getting ready, breakfast, cleaning the house. Have fixed time for everything. Preparing your lunch, having your lunch. Take rest. Have a set time of talking on phone to people. You know, this is something my father-in-law had this wonderful habit of calling everyone on a Sunday. And everyone had this habit that this is 8 o'clock and he would be calling them. So this was one wonderful habit he had. So hobby time. Yes, I would request all of you to have a fixed hobby time, that whatever you are want to do, whatever you want to pick up, be it music, be it painting, be it piano, be it cooking, try and have a fixed time where you will do your hobby. Have a fixed time for news time, have a fixed time for entertainment, dinner preparation, chat with family. If you're living with your family, try and tell everyone, before dinner, after dinner, let's all of us sit at home. If your kids are staying away, talk to them at a fixed time. Let it be a part of your routine. It will give you a sense of fulfillment. Stroll in the house or park, balcony. I have a wonderful couple. I think that they're online. They have a fixed routine for everything. They, even if they're not going out, he always counts his number of steps, Mr. Agarwal. So he has his fixed count of steps. He will always take. So this is all, you know, what they have taught me. Most of these ideas are coming from all the people I know. And go to bed at a fixed time. Avoid gadgets at night. Try and switch on some good meditation music, which will help you go to bed. So these are very simple things. You know, you might have just heard, but writing a routine is what I suggest. And those senior citizens who have a mental medical condition at home, for them, I would like you to suggest that you should just make a list of the health facility which is nearest to you. Whether you know it or not, try and have note down all the hospitals which are there nearby. Note the hospital which are COVID hospitals. I'm not trying to scare you, but I'm just trying to prepare you. In fact, this idea also came up from one of the people I know. I think she's there online. She called me to take all this information. I really felt this is a very intelligent step. She took the number of the hospitals from me. She asked me which are the hospitals which are COVID hospitals. She asked me which are the hospitals which are non-COVID hospitals. She took some doctor's number. She took my number if I'll be available. She took number of allopathic physician who is available for online consultation. So you should keep these numbers handy. Talk to your physician if he's there available online. Keep that number in your diary. Keep another number for another doctor handy. In case he's not available, whom will you contact? So that when you have a situation at that time, reaching out should not create a panic. Have emergency numbers for ambulance, for hospital. You can also note down one number for Delhi. I think it's for Delhi or India. I'll have to check. But 112 is one number. If you have any emergency, this is one number you can always dial in. Whether you need an ambulance, whether you need a police, whether you need anything, this is one number which always you should keep handy. 112. You can simply dial from a landline as well as for your mobile. The best part about this number is they will always call back in case the ring just goes and they're not able to pick up. This is the number of all the time available helpline. That's what you can keep. So take your regular medicines on time and also keep your supplies for 3 to 4 weeks, I would suggest, because sometimes due to transportation, that this condition was more prevalent earlier when the medicine supplies would be short of the chemist. So keep your supplies. All these things don't cause stress that one medicine is finished and you're looking for it. And if I have family members online, then I would like them to ask them that they should also try and, you know, talk to their elders, see what they need, whether it is food or it is essentials, talk to them at a regular basis. just talking also helps a lot. And sometimes we see that elders or you whom I'm talking to right now, they feel confused, lost, and they are not able to figure out what they need. So have small diary in your hand. Always write what you need, be it medicines, be it vegetables, be it any help what you need. Talk to the family members or order to your shopkeeper. But whenever you think of something, don't just think I'll do it in a few hours. Make a habit of writing it down. If you have children at home, keep them busy, but allow them to help. I've seen a lot of moms who have a habit of trying to do everything themselves. Now, when we don't have helps coming in, involve your children. It's okay. Involve your grandchildren. You know, it's perfectly fine to let them do this. It will give them a feeling of more responsibility, and they will also acquire new skills. All these young kids whom we have today would have to go out and study. A lot of them will have that option. So they will have to do things on their own. So you are making them well equipped if you do this, isn't it? Then, yes, in spite of trying to do all this, I know that the anxiety, fear, irritability is something which can always still trickle in. So now, when you have these kind of things, try and distance your thoughts. I'm sure that you are trying to do that. But then there are a few steps which we can talk about. When you feel angry or irritated, try and count from 10 to 1, because anger, fear, and irritation is something which is going to come when you're feeling low, when you're living in a different situation altogether. Even when you feel afraid, let's talk about a few steps which you can try. And always when I'm asking you to do this, I want you to write down, nothing verbally. What is under my control? Am I unnecessarily worrying about the worst thing that can happen? When I have been stressed about in the past, I'm sure every one of you has had a situation in the past which has been difficult or which has been more difficult than this. So what did you do at that particular time? Were you able to manage? Yes, no. If you were able to manage yourself, what did you do? If you were not able to manage yourself, whose help did you seek? Try and seek out to that person. What are the things which you can do to be positive? Write down. So now, when we are talking about all the situations, we have talked about what we can do, what we cannot do. But in my experience, a lot of people at this particular time are going through a stage of feeling low or depressed. So I would like to bring up a few slides on a very important topic, which is very close to my heart, which I feel depression is a very important part. And that is something we always ignore, especially in our country, for the stigma attached. Because it is thought that if somebody is feeling depressed, we just tell the person, come on, shun off, you know, it's okay. Just let's watch a movie. Let's go out. Let's do this. But we have to acknowledge that a person who's feeling low more than a certain hours or more than a few days, it's not a temporary phase. It might be a phase where he's having some neurochemical changes in his body, which is causing those emotionals to go low. And that is the time he needs help. And we don't have to ignore, we must provide help to that person. So let's talk. This is what I would like to say whenever you feel low. So let's talk and shed off this hesitation. Let's shed off this hesitation to talk about our feelings. So if you feel low, if you feel you're not having interest in your routine work, if you feel you're getting irritated over things which you were earlier not, if you feel you get anxious or you feel the palpitations or you feel that you have no interest left in whatsoever, or if you keep thinking about the future, if you're not able to sleep properly at night, if you think that all the things which are bringing in a lot of happiness, like talking to your friends, going out to the park, talking to family, is not bringing happiness anymore, you're not enjoying your food, you're not enjoying your hobbies, you're not able to concentrate, if you're having any of these symptoms, then you have to talk to someone. Depression, I always tell all my patients and friends, is just like any other disorder in the body. Someone might have a gastric trouble, another might have an allergy, third might have a skin disorder, and another person might have a depression. That person is not responsible for what is happening. It is the neurochemical changes happening in his or her brain. So please acknowledge it, less like you will acknowledge any person with a cough, any person with a stomach ache. Please acknowledge it. That's my sincere request to all. So myth is that person with depression is responsible. It's absolutely not so. the fact is that depression can be triggered by circumstances or any incidents in life. It's due to a neurochemical changes happening in the brain. Depression increases because people don't seek help. That's absolutely true. So if you are having any of those symptoms which I discussed, please talk to someone about it. And if you're not able to change that by talking to the people whom you're assigned to, then you must seek a medical help. So the stigma attached in a society with depression needs to shed off. Come out and talk is my request to everyone. Talk to someone. It could be your friend. It could be your spouse. It could be your parents. It could be your teacher. It could be your sibling. Any person you're comfortable with. And if that does not help, please seek a professional help. Seek help of a counselor. Seek the help of a physician. But talk. That's my sincere request. This is a poster by WHO, which was brought out in 2017. In fact, that time I also did some talks on depression and trying to motivate people. I'm talking. You know, expressing yourself. So this is a WHO's main agenda in 2017 was let's talk about depression. So recognize any mental health problems. Now, when you all are there with me online, and I'm so glad to have you all. So please recognize depression or your stress during this COVID times, during this pandemic, do not ignore it. So change in the sleep patterns, difficulty in sleep, worsening of health problems, increased use of alcohol, tobacco, or drugs, or it could be any other stimulants. So for example, if someone who was taking just 2 coffee in a day is ending to 10 coffee or 10 tea in a day, you must recognize he's needing a stimulant to stay awake. So that is also something we should not be ignored. So be supportive to them. Be supportive and lovable to yourself. If the problem persists, please contact your doctor or a mental health professional. Seek help of a counselor. You can seek help of your physician. You can also seek help of homeopathy. So that's your choice, but you know, you must say. So in this time, especially now we will first talk of the basic things which we can do. And if you're not able to come out of that, I suggest that we seek help. Stay connected, you know, talking really helps. Talk to your family, talk to your friends, talk to people whom you haven't spoken to in years together, you know. And if any of these emotions persist, as I shared, you have to talk to people. Now, another thing which we have to talk about, that, as I said, that you don't have to get scared of COVID-19. We all know, as has been announced in the medical thing, that 80% of the population is supposed to get affected by this pandemic. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to tell you the fact. So one thing or the other, there are chances that we all might get it, right? But please remember, the infection rate of this disease is very, very high, but the recovery rate is also very high. People with tuberculosis and with serious lung infections are getting more affected. Rest of the, and those who did not take the medical aid at the right time are the one who are not able to fight it. And those who are really feared of it. That's also I was told by a few doctors who work at a hospital. So staying positive, taking medical treatment at the right time. I know so many few people who are highly diabetic. They also got through COVID. They're fine now. They've come out of it today just by taking the right medical treatment at the right time. So you don't have to shun or judge people with a COVID infection. For senior citizens, if you are having a health, you need to take special care about just maintaining a social distance with your mate. For that, I can just tell you simple things like you should have a separate set of masks, a cap and gloves for all the help who come to your house. The moment they reach your house, give them a basket. Tell them to tell their mask, their footwear, and if they're wearing gloves outside in a basket. When they enter your house, they should wear a separate set of masks. If you can give cap, I would prefer that. And give them a mask, give them a cap, give them a separate pair of gloves. Let them do your work. When the mate is doing the work, you can try and keep your distance from that person. You sit in one room, let the person finish the task. After the person is finished the task, if they are doing work, for example, in your kitchen, you can simply have one habit of sanitizing that area simply to just lower down your risk. And when the person goes, you should tell them they should clean and wash their mask before they go and keep them in a separate basket before they leave. Which should be closed, which should not be open, which should remain clean. And also, if your mate is having any symptom of upper respiratory tract infection, please get them to see a doctor. And if there any of the family member has any such thing, please get them to see a doctor and do not ask them to stay at home for at least 10 to 15 days. Make sure they have seen a doctor. Make sure they've taken treatment. Do that as your responsibility for yourself. You can go out to a park. You can go out to a shop if you really need to. Just maintain your social distance. Wear a mask. And also, I would like to tell you that different kind of mask are different kind of level of protection they can have. If you're just going to a park, you can wear a small cloth mask also. If you have to go to a crowded place, for example, if you're visiting a hospital, that time I would suggest you please use a surgical mask, because that is a mask which actually gives you a higher level of protection. That is something you should maintain. Keep a set of surgical masks, keep a set of cloth masks, which you can use for different times. And if you have deliveries being given at home, maintain a social distance, wash your stuff which is coming home. Also, there is one simple thing that if you are, say, for example, getting groceries, which you're not going to use for 10 days, you don't have to really wash it if you're not touching them. Let's be very practical. If you're ordering a 10 kg bag of rice or a 5 kg bag of atta at your home and you don't want to touch it for 5 days, then you really don't have to wash it, because after 4 days, it is said that the virus gets deactivated. So whatever you have to use, immediately wash it. If you have a provision where you have a huge basket which can lie outside, and there is stuff which doesn't go bad, leave it there. Don't hassle yourself with too much of work, which is not really necessary. And if you know someone who has the infection, guide them with precautions and medical assistance if it is required. Do not stop talking to them. Talking won't really cause any problem with talking to them. So what if you are COVID positive? Or what if someone close to it COVID positive? You don't have to get scared is the first thing. Take treatment under medical guidance. As the Delhi government has now suggested that home isolation treatment is the best thing to start with. You must use home remedies, which have been suggested by the Ayush Ministry and also our Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi. I will share the list in the next few slides. You must do yoga. Yoga is something which if you would like to do, start at least with pranayam to start with. But yes, please do it under guidance. Be in touch with your physician. Monitor your temperature and oxygen. Oximeter is something which I would recommend all the senior citizens, and a thermometer for each one of you. You should keep at home. So, and oxygen levels you must monitor. This is only in case you have any risk of having COVID positive. So not otherwise. And you must seek a medical advice. Do not try to do home treatment or self-treatment or by someone who was positive what he took. The first thing is you have to contact a doctor and take proper prescription and take proper treatment. You can take homeopathy side by side, because Ayush Ministry is released guidelines for the homeopathic practice about 3 to 4 weeks back now. And all the homeopathic practitioners are using those guidelines and helping patients with COVID positive with homeopathy. Like I'm giving to a lot of patients who are positive. We are giving that as a supportive therapy. In mild cases, we're giving only homeopathy, but that's a patient choice. But ideally, conventional medicine and homeopathy, what has been suggested by the government, you must do that. So remember that most people get better. Please do not panic. Practice self-isolation, take medications. I know so many people who were positive, they even had medical conditions, and now they have followed the isolation and gone home. All they did in isolation, you have to do more activities which you could do otherwise. And the time will just, you know, go by. There's nothing to get scared of. So in recovery, while it is wonderful to recover from COVID-19, but what I have seen a few cases, there is a lot of weakness which we see after that. With that, I would recommend that during the time one is positive, you need to really focus on your diet, have a lot of fruits, healthy food, freshly cooked food, and keep yourself hydrated. Monitor temperature, oxygen, report every change to your physician. Talk to your physician as he's recommended. Most of the doctors are talking, or their juniors are talking every day, people who are in home isolation. So do not stress that how will you get back to community. Fear about loved ones falling ill. If you isolate yourself in one room, I've seen a lot of families where one or two members were positive. In some cases, other members were positive. In some cases, other members did not get positive. So this guilt or feeling of depression or helplessness, try to get rid of it. talk to someone if you want to. Talk to your physician also about it. Remain busy. We have talked about few ways. We just mentioned that, you know, you have to do counting and you have to write down how you manage your stress earlier. Share your positive experiences with everyone. You know, this is one thing which you can do. So, and once you are through, share your experience with everyone. So I think this is the time for integrative medicine. You know, Ayurveda and yoga have so many immunity boosters to offer. Homeopathy has a concept of genus epidemicus, where the homeopathy is being used in 5 states, some at the government level, some at the hospital research levels. And a lot of research is coming out of that. So in homeopathy, there is a concept, I will touch homeopathy a little bit here. And in allopathy, there is treatment which has been offered for as a basic line of treatment in cases who go into complications. This more aggressive line of treatment has been given. So I think it's a time when all the parties have to work together to help all the COVID cases. And every science has their own role, which they can play very beautifully. So I will just touch briefly about homeopathy. Rashi, can you just tell me how much time we have?
We have about 10, 15 minutes more.
Okay, great. So I'll try to sum up like that, yeah. So homeopathy, I would briefly share about that, has always played a very crucial role in treating patients of epidemics where, for example, scarlet fever, typhus fever, pneumonia, cholera, hepatitis, and in many, many pandemics, there has been evidences in homeopathic literature which tell that how homeopathy has played a role. And now we have COVID-19 in front of us. For example, in cholera, there has been time when the founder of homeopathy treated many, many thousands of cases where people have died with homeopathy. And they have been documented. There's a huge list of epidemics which occurred and where homeopathy was used. And it is evidence that homeopathy could bring in a lot of less number of mortality when homeopathy was used along with the conventional medicine. So the mortality rate decreased. So this is the time I feel that we have to combine all the pathies together and bring best to the patient, because patient's benefit is what is utmost. So this is a huge list which I'm not going to get into. And Spanish flu of 1918 is something which is really, really talked about. This was a very similar to a flu which we are facing right now. So this was also one particular epidemic where homeopathy was used in large numbers. And it did report a very low mortality of just 1.5%. And how does homeopathy really come into picture for an epidemic? In an epidemic, what happens is that actually to come to a right remedy, homeopaths need to see cases. Okay, they need to see a certain number of cases. Basically, this number is very varied. You need to see cases. They need to see what all remedies are coming up, because homeopathy is a very symptom-based treatment. Once this is what is happening at various government levels where homeopaths have been given exposure to see the cases, and a lot of findings are coming out, pre-research findings and studies are being shared with the faculty, with the fraternity, sorry. So they need to see cases and they have to see that what are the remedies which are coming out in the symptomatic cases. Out of these remedies, usually two or three remedies are come up majorly as the symptomatic remedies in cases of epidemics, because at that particular time, as per the homeopathic concept, in case of epidemic, the load of the epidemic or the virus or the bacteria, whatever is causing the epidemic, is much higher than the immunity of the entire population. So there the individual immunity is not really able to play a role. And that is the only reason where individualistic homeopathy has lesser role and where most of the people would come out with similar symptoms. So this is what I'm writing here has been suggested by one of the stalwarts of homeopathy, who's Kent, Dr. J.T. Kent. He says that you have to see cases, right? Remedies in front of each symptom. Find out whether the majority remedy coming out in the disease picture. You will arrive at, this is for the doctors basically, the doctor arrives at 6 to 7 remedies. This is known as a group epidemicus. The doctor is supposed to make a picture of 6 to 7 remedies. And then this chart can be used as a reference guideline. And that's what Kent has said, that very rarely the patients would be out of this particular picture. So all these findings which are coming out from different states, if a homeopath is well versed with it, he knows what are the remedies being mainly used in the cases being treated. He can make a list of those remedies. And whenever a COVID contact cases is contacting him or her, then they need to take the symptoms of the patient and see what remedy fits in and prescribe the remedy. So you can contact your physician, homeopathic physician also, if there is any person who is positive. Arsenic was suggested very rightly by the CCRH in 2020 March, but now they are also doing more studies at different places where, because this was based on the symptoms which were presented from the China pandemic. But now when the cases are available in India, the research is being done by the council and also by the Delhi government, which they're about to publish. That's what we were told last. And there they are going to share the findings, which are the remedies which are practically coming useful. They have shared some data with the fraternity, which I'm thankful to them, and we are using it when we are treating these cases. So what should you do as a patient? You should seek help of a practitioner of homeopathy. If you want to add homeopathy to your line of treatment, do not self-medicate, please. Ayush guidelines have been issued for the practitioners, and they will advise you the remedy as per se. Even if you're advised the same remedy which your friend might have got, but that's again as per the guidelines, and you will be in safer hands that way. So then again, Ayush Ministry had shared some beautiful guidelines, which I think some of you are already aware that, which I really, swear by, that you should do some yoga, pranayama for at least 30 minutes as advised by the ministry. You can do 50 minutes in the morning, 50 minutes in the evening. You can add spices like turmeric, jeera, dhania, and lasun. We all use it in our cooking, right? But if actually you overcook it while you're making your tadka, let me be very honest, all the benefits go away. So I suggest you can simply, now when it's so much heat, a lot of people are not able to take the kadha. So I suggest you can simply have a light tea made out of turmeric, honey, and some ginger and tulsi in the evening. That is something, because some people were calling me back that they were not able to have all these herbs, they were having stomach issues. So those who can have some of these herbs which are written here, like tulsi, dalchini, kali mirch, ginger, munakka, you can have that. Those who are not able to have that, just have made a simple tea which has turmeric, which has some honey in it, which has tulsi, and you can even keep changing your spices. One day you can have two spices, one day you can have three spices, so that your taste changes. And you can also have your milk with turmeric. In fact, I would suggest if you all can really get hold of the fresh turmeric, which is available in the market, which looks like ginger, that's most beneficial, because that is actually something which is not related. And if you have some upper respiratory tract infection, first thing is you have to see a physician. That's I would really, really insist on. You have to talk to your physician, your allopathic physician, your homeopathic physician, or whatever you want to talk to. And you can do all these applications when you have just upper respiratory. Even if now when your physician differentiates is just a common cold, then also you can do these therapies. And if it looks like a COVID case and you have to report back after 2 days of testing, then also. So your physician would be the best person to advise you whether you need the test or you do not need the test. Do not panic. Please talk. Talking is the most important thing here. So nasal application of sesame oil, coconut oil, or ghee. You can do oil pulling therapy, which you can try. Please do not do this therapy unless you have been trained or you take some guidance for it. That's my suggestion. If you have a dry cough, you can use pudina. You can also, I advise to a lot of my patients that you can put some tulsi leaves and then inhale that water. You can also use different kind of herbs. Like one day you can just put some tulsi leaves in your water and drink that whole day. One day you can put some lemongrass leaves in your water. We talked about growing lemongrass, so please do that. So some basic herbs which are immunity booster are holy basil, ginger, fenugreek, garlic, turmeric. I'm sure you all know that. But start using them in as much as raw form as you can, not just in cooking, but do not overdo it. Because you all know that all these Indian herbs are also very, very strong, and we are in summer. So use them in a small, small quantities and try and use them on alternate days or stuff like that. So see, as I think we already talked about that, I'm just bringing up the slide again, that you have to have a doctor's number handy. You have to have your physician's number handy. You have to have your online consultation numbers handy. Try and keep two numbers for this. An emergency numbers for doctor, hospital, ambulance. 112 is which I have told you already, which works in Delhi, I'm sure. take your regular medicines on time. For example, if you are taking a blood pressure medicine, you are taking a diabetes medicine, I'm talking about the allopathic medicines also, please take them at a fixed time. Not just now, always. Because there is a certain threshold which needs to be maintained in the blood. If you take at different times every day, it is going to affect the dosage. Do not decrease any such drug, be it thyroid, be it diabetes, be it blood pressure, be it diabetes. Do not decrease it unless you talk to your physician. If your BP is remaining normal, because sometimes I get this question, so I'm bringing this up here. Some of you must already be aware, but I have a lot of people who have this question, that since my BP was normal, my sugar was normal, I stopped this medication. They're absolutely right in, because we have always been told when you're fine, you stop the medication. But these are certain life conditions. Once you have it, your body needs a certain dosage to maintain that threshold. If your BP or your sugar is going extremely low, contact your physician. You know, talk to them again. That's what you need to do. So then again, I believe a lot in food, and a lot of my patients who are there online would know that I always insist on eat this, eat that, though I'm not a dietitian, it's not my expert area. But I always suggest some good foods as per the condition they have. So I always suggest all the people that eat fresh food, try and avoid fridge food as much as possible. As per Ayurveda, our Shastras say that we should eat our food within 1.5 hours of cooking. Then after that, it starts degenerating. So if you can do that, that's the best thing you can do to yourself. Eating healthy food, you know. Cook it and have it. And trust me, the taste of that food is so delicious. We started this like for my parents when my mom had a certain condition. And I really could see the difference in the taste of the food and her health condition. So have a lot of green vegetables. Have seasonal fruits. These days you have mango, you have watermelon, you have, because seasonal foods basically work most as antioxidants. And you can also have egg white, you can have paneer, you can have low fat milk, you can make vegetable soups, and all the things which you all know. Avoid canned foods, avoid food with preservatives, as raw. And something which I always say again, try and have one meal as raw. If you can do that, nothing like it. So because then you're filling your one particular diet with raw food, and that you're just taking care of your health. 40% you are done. And yes, this is all the mind games you can play. You can play some Ludo. You can play some chess. You can play some puzzles. You can play some Sudoku. I have been playing Ludo with my son these days, and he's always beating me. So you can also try with each other and let me know who wins. So be prepared for every situation. As we talked about, keeping the numbers handy, your physician numbers handy. You can also note my number if you ever need help or any guidance in an emergency. And so save the doctor's number, save your physician's number in your phone as well as in your diary. Do not just keep at one place. And this is one beautiful thing which Miss Manisha Bajaj also does. She had given her number to a lot of senior citizens in the colony, which her mother stays in. It was such a beautiful gesture. I remember she told me this about so many years back, but I still remember. So all the senior citizens where her mom stays have her number fixed up on the wall. So if there is an emergency, they can contact her. So this way, keep the numbers handy. In fact, that's the best way you can do. Just put it next to your bed. You know, suppose your phone is not working at that time, so keep it like that. Have 2-3 numbers over there. So stay prepared for every situation. Stay prepared in case you fall sick or something. Make sure you have your medicines and save your doctor's number, save your family's number, talk to them. And keep your surroundings clean. That is also important. Use a good quality sanitizer. There are so many sanitizers available in the market who do not have an adequate amount of alcohol. So please do your research a little bit and then buy the sanitizer. You can always buy in bulk. Ensure that your house where you're staying is disinfected regularly by a simple sanitizer, and especially the doorknobs and the handles where your people are coming in, people are going out, and your maids are coming in, your vendors are coming in. So doorknobs and gates is the most important thing to sanitize. Like I sanitize my gate, my door handles. This is the two things I sanitize every day. And my car, the car door. That's it. Rest everything, and wherever your help is using more often, you can do that. And so next thing is practice gratitude. I really believe in that. So I am so thankful to all of you who are there online. I'm so thankful to Manisha. So that is one thing which I would like all of you to do. Before I hand over to the mic, I would like to just do a quick reminder that we have talked about four things. First is, please have a daily routine. Trust me, you will really find it more encouraging, more positive. You can share your daily routine with us later. You can send it to Rashi on the email, or you can send it to me, and I would love to have it, what you're doing. We talked about five plants which you all will have in your house. One is tulsi, one is snake plant, when you can have lemongrass and syngonium, and also money plant. Money plant you can keep in your balconies because it is set to remove a lot of the pollutants in the air. You can have 2-3 money plants. Snake plant is something you can keep inside your room. Do not water it. You can just put water maybe once in 2 weeks or when the mud is completely dry, and then you will see multiple of them grow in it. If you put too much water, it'll dry. You can also have jade, in fact. Jade is also one plant which brings in a lot of positivity. And also, it takes away the pollution. So please have these 5-6 plants. I'm a plant lover. And if you all would have it, I would be very happy. And yes, you all have to get one hobby. You have to develop it, and you have to tell any of us what is something. You know, you can do simple things like music, learning, dance, yoga, exercise. Even if you're doing yoga, please join a formal class. I'm sure it will be an upgrade. Do painting, you know. I started painting in this COVID time, after I don't know how many, 20, 25 years. I did my first painting with my son yesterday, like we were doing for a few days. So it's amazing how we can, you know, get back to it. It's so satisfying, and it's so much fun. Sketching, cartoon making, there's so much happening online. Theater, so you can join any theater class which is available online. Writing, meditation. You can just make simply some paperbacks if you want. You can make some lovely pickles if you are. We have Mrs. Kiran Agarwal who made some delicious pickles. I know she gave me one, so I'm waiting for another pack if you're online. So this is all, stay connected. That's very important. You have to have a fixed time when you will talk to your family members. You will talk to your friends if family members are away. They're not available all the time. Keep your numbers handy. Keep your house clean. Try and do simple cooking and have as much of food as you can have raw. If you're staying alone, try and stick to a lot of fruits, lightly cooked vegetables, so that you don't have to do too much heavy cooking. Maybe you can have vegetable at one time and dal at one time, but a lot of fruits in both the meals. So you're not overloading yourself with work. And whatever you all do, whatever activities, please do share with us. We would love to hear from you. So again, practice gratitude. So I would like to thank Harikrit. I think the spelling is not correct. I'm so sorry. Dr. Manisha Bajaj, Ms. Rashi, people who joined in. I'm so thankful to you all. All the elders who have been, you know, there to guide me, who have put their trust in me when they gave them medicine. So all the family and friends, and to Almighty, of course, that he made me join this field. And I'm here today sitting and talking to you all, you know. So I would like to hand over the mic to Rashi and Ms. Manisha ji.
Thank you very much, Geeta ji, for this wonderful session today. It was so much, filled with information. And now some questions, I've been receiving questions directly over the chat also right now. So the first question which comes to you is that recently in news, there were a lot of discussion about a homeopathy medicine and it helping boost your immunity. So do you have any comment on that?
Yes. In March, the government had advised taking arsenic album 30, because I did not go into that detail. I already had a slide that it was based on data which said that arsenic is the most common remedy for flu, and arsenic was also found to be useful in raising certain enzymes which help in boosting the immunity. And the government has distributed a lot of arsenic. And it was all based on the data which they had from China. At that time, India did not have the cases. So they wanted to give arsenic and see what it will do. And based on the finding they had, and also arsenic was the genus Epidemicus, in the previous common flu, which was there in India, like the swine flu. So based off that, they gave. So that was an absolutely good recommendation by the council at that time. Now they are start getting the cases, now they're getting the data, and they are working on it to see that how much effective arsenic was, right? So whether the arsenic has helped or not, the data is still to come from the government. They're still doing their studies. They've distributed to a lakhs and lakhs of people. But also at the same time, government has rightly started actually seeing the cases, like in Delhi government is doing. So now they are coming up with other remedies which are coming as useful in COVID cases. We are still waiting for data to get published. But yes, that data was shared to some extent with the fraternity when they attended. We were, you know, the courses were done by the government. We attended the webinars by the Delhi government I'm specifically talking about. They shared what are the remedies they are finding useful. And when they asked us to start seeing patients, so we are using that guideline only for treating the patients. And once those guidelines are published, that will also come out that what is the, now the practical remedy to be given as a preventive. So let's wait, let's hold on to that. For example, like if I am treating a case of COVID, the remedy which I give to the patient of the family, which comes is just totality remedy. I also give the same remedy to the other family members as a preventive for that family. And so far it has been working. And this was something which I discussed with the, when we were trained about the webinar, and I discussed with our director that do you think this will work? He said, yes, absolutely. You should do that. You know, you can do that and see what happens. So it's a new disease. We all are learning. Let me be very, very honest about it. Never in my practice, I have been I'm a homeopath. I see a case and I would usually see the case after 15 days or 1 week. In COVID cases, I keep a morning, evening follow-up, just like a hospital doctor does. I talk to them every evening. I receive their temperature chart. I receive their oxygen chart. Even if they are contacting their physician, I keep in touch with them every day till they are symptomatic. After that, once they're asymptomatic, I keep in touch every 3 days. So this is a new disease. We all are learning. I am using a lot of other remedies other than arsenic. In few cases, I did use arsenic as a treatment remedy, but I'm using other remedies also. So ideally, the best thing now is if you have taken arsenic, that's very good because the government suggested it. If you have any symptoms, please seek the help of your registered homeopathic practitioner who would do the symptomatic treatment as per your symptoms and as per the guidelines which we have been trained on by the ministry.
So basically, any kind of self-treatment, even if it is advised like this, should be avoided. You should definitely go to your practitioner and take their advice before doing that, right?
Absolutely.
So that is that. Another question which came up a minute ago was how to sanitize your footwear. But before we ask you to answer that, just a point to all the participants over here. If you have a question, please put it on the chat. And for whatever reason, if you're not able to do so, you can just raise your hand. There is an option in participants and I will unmute you and ask you to ask your question from Geetaji directly. So that is also possible. So the next question, what I mentioned is how to sanitize your footwear.
See, usually my suggestion is that the footwear which you use for outside, you should not bring that footwear inside. Just fix one footwear which you're using for outdoor these days. Keep it outside and just use that only for coming and going out. Come inside and wash your feet. That's the best thing. If you can wash your footwear outside with plain running water, that's also the best thing to do. If it's a leather shoe, obviously you cannot wash it like that. So you can simply rub it off, take a cloth and rub it off completely and wash your hands with soap and water. Keep that footwear outside only if you're using it for going out. Do not bring it in. That's my suggestion. Yes.
Okay. That's great. There was another question. If you could repeat the name of the plants that have to be kept indoors.
That's snake plant, which you can keep inside. Snake plant is something which you can keep in each and every room because that is one plant which releases oxygen 24 hours a day. That is what you can keep inside. Even jade you can keep inside. And you can keep syngonium plant near to your window if you have. It needs some sunlight at least to get through. And you should keep lemongrass and money plant in your balcony. You know? So this is a very personal advice, to be very frank. This is not a very medical advice, but, you know.
So there is another question. My father is CKD and diabetic too. Is it advisable to allow him to go for morning and evening walks? Till date, I'm avoiding and not allowing him to step out. Also, what all can he take to increase his immunity when he's already on lots of medication for kidney, heart, diabetes, and high BP?
Okay. See, if he wants to step out, if you have an area where there are not many people coming in, choose the time when, for example, if he can get up early, if you can choose a time between 6 to 7, where there are not many people, he can actually go out. If he was already going out for walk, tell him that he has to maintain a distance of at least 3 meters from anyone he meets. If you can accompany him, that's the best thing to do. So you go with him, you do a small stroll in the park. If he wants to talk to anyone, you have to very respectfully and politely tell the other person that let's maintain a distance. He can go out with a mask. But if he's very fit, I don't know the health condition. If he's like very fit, he was doing walks earlier. If you want to do aggressive walk, then he has to take off his mask also, because otherwise it will be difficult for him. So he can go for a walk, provided you maintain a social distance of 3 meters from everyone. And if the other person is also wearing a mask, you are also wearing a mask, then it's perfectly okay to go out. That's what the suggestions are coming, you know. That's what the suggestion. And for immunity, the herbs which we talked about, that's what you can do. Those are the herbs which have been suggested by the Ayush Ministry. If you want, I can email, I just showed you the slides. I can send that PDF also on email if anybody wants, the ministry PDF.
Okay, that would be great. In fact, just to let everybody know, we are also live on Facebook. So what would happen, the entire video would stay on the Facebook page of Sanji San, so you can always go back and check the video if you want to revisit certain part of whatever the doctor has shared with us today. So another question coming from the point of talking about arsenic is that, is there any other medicine in homeopathy which can be taken as a preventive measure, and has arsenic helped in this pandemic, and if yes, how much and what are the dosage one should take?
See, the arsenic final data is yet to come out from the council side, because it's the council. See, people have distributed. A lot of doctors have distributed, but the data maintenance is something which is very necessary. We cannot claim anything, only come out from the council that what is happening. And any medicine, let's be very open with any medicine, is never prevent. The genus epidemicus, which will come out now out of the studies, it will also be preventive in 80% of the cases or 60% of the cases. Rest always still have the risk of infection, but the benefit over there will be, you will know that this is the remedy which will not be useful for him and he will need other remedies. So arsenic data is yet to come out from the government side, and they will be the best people to comment on it. They are collecting the data. That's the best part about it. Council is distributed to a lot of containment zones, and they are following up that data, because the containment zones were made in April. So they have distributed, and so they are now getting the data, how many people of that get affected, how many did not get affected. See, if they distributed to 10,000 people, they have actually distributed that. If out of those 10,000, if only 300 are getting affected, then also it's a big number, isn't it? So yeah, the numbers are yet to come up. Mm-hmm.
So there's another question continuing from this is, as you have treated many patients of COVID, how many cases you have seen in patients even after taking, who have taken Ayush recommended herbs?
See, I have cases, to be, let me honest with that. But yes, I have treated a few positive cases and a lot of contacts, because the person who is positive, their family members are most likely get to have it. So what we do is we treat the first patient who is highly symptomatic and moderate case, or was tested because he has a lot of symptoms. We treated that, and the other family members had mild symptoms. Most of them had it, to be honest. Then we started treating them also, considering they are also positive, kept them also in isolation. And yes, I think I did have 2 or 3 cases who had taken arsenic already. 2 cases who had already taken arsenic in the past. Rest had not taken arsenic. Yes.
So basically, we can continue to say what you advised earlier, that each patient is different from the other, and the doses and the treatment could differ, and one should not copy what was given to the other person.
As of now, yes, but yes, once the genus epidemicus is out, like for example, we are using genus epidemicus concept in a very small way. If I'm treating one patient, I'm giving all his contacts the same medicine. So I'm using that concept. I'm not taking symptoms of his other family members who do not have symptoms. So I'm giving them as a preventive. Once this genus epidemics is out by the Delhi government studies, then that remedy can be used as a preventive. We are waiting for those results to be out. We have some idea, let me share with you, but yes, it should come out to the right channel, you know, so please wait for it.
Yeah, basically you need an expert to do it. We cannot self-medicate. We need the doctor's advice to take or not take any particular line of treatment.
Yes. And so, government will advise on what can be used as a preventive very soon. That's what I believe.
Okay, that would be great. We would all be waiting for that. Participants, if you have any more questions, please feel free to ask. I am out of questions as of now. So if you have any questions, you can ask. You will not get this amazing opportunity with Dr. Geeta Arora, who is sitting around say to answer all your queries. So please, if you have any other questions, feel free to ask her. Seems like we have had a great session. In fact, actually, you've shared a lot of things with us, Geeta ji, which were so, you know, big eye-openers and things which is very good, which we can do every day and ensure better protection and prevention at our end. So, okay, some personal questions are coming your way. I could just see one. Do you have online consultation, Dr. Geeta? If yes, can we have your number?
Yes, I do online consultations. I'm doing. So Rashi, how do you want to share the number? You want me to tell here? How do you want to do it?
It's absolutely up to you. I could type the number if somebody wants to write it, or we could, or we could do another thing is, I would save the chat and
it's okay. You can tell them now. There are the few participants. So
okay. So if you could just, if you could just share it, I will type it down.
It's 9818 0909 0909 53 53. And there is one more number, 97180.
One second, I'll just write that down also.
97180.
180.
63 63 158 158. Yeah, these both numbers are available on WhatsApp for a video call, and my preferable timings are from 10:30 to 2 o'clock, because I'm doing a morning OPD only during COVID times. So this is the best time to connect. But if anybody has any emergency, you can call me anytime.
10 a.m. to 2 p.m. That's right. Right?
Yes, that's right. Yes, yes, yes.
So here are the details for everybody to note down. So you can copy this and keep it with you. Thank you very much, Geeta ji, for sharing your details with everybody and giving this session. I am sure people would have noted that number down. In case somebody misses it, please feel free to get in touch with me or Manisha ji. We will be happy to help you and share details of Geeta ji with you even on a later date. So it was a great session today. Manisha ji, I would really like, if you would like to share a few words before we close the session today. Manisha ji, you are on mute. So if
Manisha ji, I'm waiting to see you.
Well, I'm so grateful, Dr. Geeta, that you have been there and you have shared your precious time with us. And in fact, all the participants who were there, and we could make it a success. And somehow I was just going through a document where I saw that there are around 70% of senior citizens who are facing these health complications, and they are fearing that they might develop some problem or the other because of the restrictions around. And In fact, going on the psychological side of them, they are also undergoing some pressure in their interpersonal relationship, because now the family is all together and the time is actually too much to be spent together. And there are a percent of elderly people who are saying they're feeling good, because nowadays there is the pollution rate has gone down. So we're in a place where we are finding so many negative things about the COVID and the problems and the hassles, we are also getting a feel and a reference from people that yes, we have improved our quality of environment. There is less of pollution. There are so many things which have reduced. So, I must say that this pandemic has given us a new style of living, new way of exploring things, and new ways of addressing each other. See, now Dr. Geeta is available right here. Otherwise, it would have been that you have to actually go and visit her in her clinic. So this is another way. And we have explored it in this COVID time only. This video conferencing was available even before COVID. But we have started using it now frequently. So I think this is another one positive. And we have added many positive steps in our lives because of this COVID thing. And again, I am grateful to you all who have been with us. Thank you for everything. Thank you, Rashi. Thank you, Dr. Geeta. And thank you all the participants. And we look forward for more such great sessions in coming days. Yes. Thank you.
Absolutely. So our next session is going to be on 18th July. Same time, we would share the details of what the session would be about in the days to come. So that we would be doing. So this is every second, after every alternate Saturday is when we do this session. So that is the idea, to give as much information and, be a support system to as many people as possible.
Wonderful.
So thanks a lot, Dr. Geeta, for being here and helping us and always being there. I remember, like I was saying in the beginning, I know you for 3 years now, and every time with that smile of yours, you've always been there, ready to support us and give us moral encouragement. So thank you once again for being here with us today. And thank you all the participants for your interaction, questions, because we also learn when you ask questions, there are areas we may have not thought about. So when you ask questions, that is additional knowledge and learning even for us. So thank you very much for your participation and being here today.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Oh, bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.